Bonsoir. Vous parlez le français? Vous voulez prendre un verre avec moi?
J'ai le quoi comprendre.
Oh. Oh. Même classe de tout.
Good morning, hello, and welcome to Kunstinstituut Melly. Today, my name's Vivian Zahol. I'm the Research Program Manager here at Kunstinstituut Melly. And today's program is a special day of conversation and dialogue that we host on the occasion of Art Rotterdam. The program is called Creating, Collecting, and Giving, and we'll be delving into many topics around the important question of acquisition, collecting, and collector's ethics. So I will shortly hand over to our director, Sophia Hernandez-Chonghui, who will introduce some points on the day as well as today's opening panel. But before then, just a note that the program will be live streamed. So it's an intimate gathering and we look forward to having some close conversations. But as questions come up, please do be careful to speak into the microphone so that our online audience is able to follow along with us. And please be welcome if you are tuning in online. Be welcome to ask some questions and we can have a relay perhaps through the YouTube comments as well. Thank you, Anna. Sophia.
Thank you, Vivian. I'm very happy to be joined this morning, not only by all you in the public and those connecting online, with the Director of Collections at Cadist. It's pronounced differently depending on the country. Marie Martial, did I pronounce it well? Okay. And with the Director of LAM in Lycée here in the Netherlands. In the case of this program, what we were interested in organizing in conjunction to Art Rotterdam and in cooperation with Art Rotterdam, the Contemporary Art Fair, was a program of the full day to really analyze the changing art context that we see here in the Netherlands and to be able to learn from our peers in the region. The changing context of the arts is one that I would say is guided by discussion around public subsidies and private funding. And a lot of this private funding has to do not so much with corporations as it is in other countries, but specifically with philanthropists, lovers of the arts, and in many cases, people that for the first time are stepping in the art field and into the sector, very excited with the production of artists. And what we see in this changing context as well is the emergence of institutions that are privately funded, privately owned, but opened to the public. What this program hopefully will bring about to bear is some of the missions of these institutions and the kind of work that they do, especially to support the practice of living artists. I think that both institutions can teach us very much of the focuses of how artists are involved in the creation of collections, but also the direction of institutions that are very committed to public engagement, ways in which they bring audiences into contact with contemporary art and the different methodologies in which that happens. Sometimes it's through exhibitions, sometimes it is through educational activities, and in our case here at Kunstinstituut Melly, one of the things that we certainly love to do is projects and events that are at the intersection of arts and education. So for us, as it is for the audiences tuning in today, the conversation today that we'll have after brief presentations about the two institutions, KDIST and LAM, is to learn from our peers that are in the region, both in the Netherlands and in this case, France, although the venue is also in San Francisco, the United States. I'm gonna pass directly to Marie to give us an introduction of her institution, and then to Sitske to learn also about her institution, and then we'll open up for conversation. Sounds good. And of course, if I see Lynn here, Lynn Kramer, yay! She has the wireless microphone, so just raise your hand whenever you want to ask a question throughout the session, so that, again, not only we can hear you, but the audiences that are tuning live stream can be able to hear your question and be responded and have a conversation with us. Thank you. Marie, I pass it on to you.
Thank you, Sophia. And thank you for the invitation to be here today and to all of you for joining. I'm going to give you a little bit of context about KDIST so you also know where we're coming from in the conversations. So as Sophia said, KDIST depends a little bit on the context. Maybe I wanted to start with giving you a little bit of a more context about the mission. So we're a nonprofit organization that is dedicated to supporting the work of artists, often living artists, in that engage with important issues of today, which is also a focus of the collections, but I'll talk about it a little bit later. So we do that through different programs. First, we want to encourage this engagement with important issues of today through, for example, exhibitions, events, residencies. The idea is also to exhibit their work, so more person from the public would know about the important work they're doing. And we also want to affirm the role of contemporary art within social discourses. So thinking about audiences who might not be necessarily very familiar with art, but trying to also bring art outside of the field of art. A bit about the history of KDIST. As mentioned, it's a nonprofit. It was founded in 2001 by two family members, Sandra Turgeman and Vincent Worms, in Paris. They started the foundation also with a group of advisors, and then a couple of years later started a space in San Francisco. Today, we also have offices in Mexico and China, not physical spaces, but really agents on the ground that are working to create partnerships and programs in the regions. And we are working with a group of 20 to 25 advisors also on the collection. Here are some photos of our spaces. So here you can see the exteriors. There are two spaces that are on the ground floor, so very accessible from the street. And here you have the interiors with two installations that were site-specific for the spaces with artists from the collection. They're, in terms of sizes, to give you a sense, they're not very big, they're modest size, maybe perhaps the size of this room or a little bit bigger. The idea was to also create a space that's intimate, also for events and exhibitions, so we can have a very personal experience with art and conversations. So maybe now a little bit about the collection itself. The collection is a starting point for everything we do, and it addresses social issues and engages in discussion on contemporary topics. It comprised today about 1,600 artworks that illustrate the diversity of artist practice, and it's growing by about 100 artworks each year. It represents about 1,000 artists, which are from all over the world. We recently did a little bit of a kind of audit and looked at, realized there was 120 different nationalities that were represented in the collection, from the well-known to the emerging. All of them focus on the contemporary, so most of the collection is from the 21st century, with a bit of exceptions. There is no specific medium, though there is a big representation of digital medium like photography, videos, also more like recently virtual reality. And for us, the collection is really a resource, not only for our programs, but also for other institutions' programs. So the collection is available for loans. We're trying really to make art accessible to different types of publics. And in this spirit, everything is online. So the entire collection is available on the website with the text that's written by our advisors or team. Everything also is possible to like have inquiries if you want to know more about an artworks. And the idea is really through the programs and the collection that's a starting point to create more exchanges around art and urgent issues of our time. Here is a little bit of just an overview of the advisors that are helping us do that. They're all based in different regions across the world. The pandemic somehow was in the beginning a transition that worked quite well for us because we continued a lot of the conversation that we were having across the world through Zoom, among others. I think I might have skipped. No, maybe it's a. I think it's missing a slide, but it's okay. Just maybe to tell you about the collection process, the acquisition process. We have about 6 acquisition meetings per year. So we gather all of our advisors. Everybody is welcome to join. It's a very democratic process. Everybody has one vote. So the family that started the collection has the same vote that someone who entered the collection, entered the staff very recently. We review the work, discuss the work, and then vote. And at the end of the year, we share also some news about, we'll circulate the information with the entire group, even though the one that couldn't attend. And then after that, we create a different programs with the artists in the collection. So we also think about the collection, not only as a collection of objects, but really thinking about the group of artists who we are hoping to continue building relationship with through different programs. So as mentioned, exhibitions, residency, events, but also online projects. We organize exhibitions in partnerships and collaborations with different organizations, curators, but also artists throughout the world. And I would say perhaps thinking about public engagement, those are perhaps the ones that are addressing also more general public through really seeing art and the artworks. We also organize a series of events in our spaces, and those are more dedicated for art-focused audiences, so not necessarily arts professional like us, but also a public that might be interested in knowing more about the issues and the practice. And then we organize residencies and professional gatherings, for artists and curators. So those are more dedicated towards arts professionals in a sense. Here you can see also we support the productions of new works. So Jamin Cha was a resident in San Francisco, and through her 3 months was able to meet people locally, but also develop a new work in relation to the context. We also have some online tools that are thinking about accessibility, also not only physically, but online. So we started like an online video library that's featuring hundreds of videos, not only artworks from the collection. So all the video artworks in the collection are accessible via streaming for free. You just need to create an account. We also have been documenting a lot of our conversations and events, so you can also access the archives for these conversations, and we also create artist interviews. And more recently, we also developed a tool to search the collection through thematics. So that's something we call the wheel. It's accessible, not necessarily visible like this on the website, but if you search for a theme or an important issues, you would be you will be able to have results that are generated through an algorithm. And those last two, I would say, are probably more directed to our arts professionals and researchers and students or curators who wants to look at artworks in different ways. And I think that's it for me.
So before we pass on the microphone to Sitske, I want to mention a couple of things. It seems at the start of the presentation, there was a painting of Hulda Guzman, which I think she's an artist from the Dominican Republic, a young artist that has been very much painting all these scenes that are unlikely representative of the Latin America that we know in contemporary art circuits, the mainstream. In this case, Hulda Guzman has really focused on presenting a kind of hedonist culture that is kind of not very accepted in the critical thinking of the mainstream, that tends to bring to bear more difficult and socially grounded conflicts that happen in other regions. So I find that the example of Hulda Guzman here, who's also not exactly in the art market, affairs and gallery presentations, is someone that actually probably emerges from the advisory group of a network that really knows the context and the importance of what the artist and her entire family, which is a family of artists and filmmakers, can have in a region that's so local in the Dominican Republic, but suddenly finds itself, you know, being presented right now in a PowerPoint in Rotterdam. So I think that one of the things that we can do also within this conversation today is ask even questions about the artists that are there, who are they, and what it means for them to be presented within a discussion around global contemporary art and institutions today. Very difficult, again, as I said, to have identified an artist like Hulda Guzman for a collection in Paris or San Francisco, if not having an advisory group that's rooted and anchored in the region or in multiple regions to understand the importance of an artist's work, regardless of the fact that it could be read sensibly or more accurately, I would say, outside of that context. So I think that that's quite nice. And of course, I want to ask questions about the wheel, which seems a great pedagogical tool, not only for collections, but for audiences in general that can use it perhaps to arrive at institutions to understand what is happening in the exhibitions and the artworks that they're looking at. Sitske, I welcome you to give us a presentation of LAM in Lycée here in the Netherlands. For those that are from the Netherlands, I'm unsure if you visited the museum, but of course we're going to get a great presentation from Sitske today. And if we haven't visited, for sure, we'll want to. Sitske.
Thank you, Sophia. Thank you all. My name is Sitske van Zandt. I'm director of the LAM Museum, part of the Van den Broek Foundation. The LAM only opened in 2019, so we quite recently opened museum for the public and only opened for 1 year after then 2 years of COVID. So reopening again. So we still feel as we are in our opening year. We really want to be the first Sony amongst museums. I don't know, so if I look at the audiences, we all know how the first Sony wanted us to hear music on our own with our Walkman. We want to be a museum where people that have no knowledge about art, have ever set foot in a museum, feel welcome and feel encouraged to go to all these beautiful institutes. So that's what we want to, that's our main focus. How it began. You probably all have ever noticed that when you were walking down the street and you pass by a restaurant or a shop and you look inside and you would say, this is not for me, I'm not going in. And then later on, maybe in life or maybe because someone else introduces you, you set foot in this shop or in this restaurant and you really feel welcome and it is for you and it's still interesting. But at first, it was something at more distance. And that's actually the starting point of the whole foundation. the family behind the foundation, the eldest son, he was walking, living in Amsterdam, walking at the Museumplein, passing by the big windows of the Sandberg Institute wing of the Stedelijk Museum, looking inside, and his dad would say, "Come along, boy, this is not for us." But he always got intrigued by this art world, but he never really felt at ease. And then later in life, that was his mission to support it because it enriches his own life and he wants to break that for other people as well. So he started this foundation and really wanted to encourage people to go to artists, to go to museums, to go to these institutes and enjoy the arts. So that's how the foundation was founded. We started from scratch. So the foundation was founded in 2008. At first we supported existing institutions. We supported the Royal Orchestra with its talent program. We supported the Tekenschool of the Rijksmuseum, all educational programs, all for young artists or young musicians. And there was always this wish to make and build an own collection and an own museum. So in 2012, we signed the grounds to build a new museum. And in 2015, we started the construction. But also from the beginning, from 2008, that was the moment that we started to collect. So it's not a collection that was already private and growing and a wish to show it to the public, but it's the other way around. So we started from scratch with an idea that we wanted to build a public institution. And from that moment, we started to collect art. Within that collection, we wanted to have a focus point, because if you want to build a museum or a public space and you want to start to collect, the art market is so broad where to start. So we decided to choose a theme for collecting art, and within that theme to take something that was close to the family, which is food, as they earn their money from supermarkets and food. So we set up this theme of collecting art related to food or consumption. At the beginning, the board of the foundation was a bit hesitant, as it would be boring, maybe, that we could only collect still lives. But then, in the end, as food we all relate to, also artists relate to food, it's everywhere. And even artists you don't think about have somewhere in their oeuvre a work of art that is related to food. So now it's almost difficult to select and be really specific of the things we still are in need to collect. Within that collection, we really look at a variety. So we look at emerging artists, unknown artists, local Dutch artists, international artists, world-known artists, because we want to have like a cadence or a pace for the visitors to sometimes recognize works of art and sometimes get new works that you've never seen before or you would pass by. And even when we're collecting now, the collection itself is the big threat or the biggest criticaster of what new work should come into this collection. Do we need something more interactive, or do we need something that is catchy and people will like it just because of its craftsmanship? Or do we need something that is more conceptual and it's more challenging? So all these questions are asked from the whole of the collection every time we purchase a new work of art. And since we started from 2008 collecting, and since we are such a new collection and look at the diversity of the market, we actually have already a quite diverse collection, not only in age of artists that are represented from the contemporary art, but also from different countries from all over the world, and also in female and male percentages of artworks that are represented in the collection. For now, I think we have about 43% is female and the rest is male. And comparing to other collections, I think most of the collections are the other way around, and there's still a lot of male artists in their collection represented instead of female artists. We are located at the estate of Keukenhof, which is famous for its tulips. And with the theme food, which connects to our visitors, we also bring the food back to the estate of Keukenhof, Because in the Netherlands, everybody, when you hear the word keukenhof, you think of tulips, and you don't hear the name keuken, which means kitchen, in the name of the estate. But originally, in the 15th century, it was the estate of Jacoba van Beieren, and she gathered her herbs and berries for her own kitchen. That's where, hence the name. So we bring back food again back to this tulip estate. And we don't have any tulips in our... Oh, we do have some artworks with tulips, but most has nothing to do with our next-door neighbor tulip experience. Our main focus in everything what we do, in how we collect and what we do, is the visitor, our audience. So we think of our audience in everything we do. We think, how do you feel at ease in a museum? It all has to do with trust and a warm welcome. So we guide you through the museum. We have, in every floor, we have view coaches, as we call them. They're not regular attendants in the museum. They're not guides, so they will not start talking and tell you everything about the artworks, but they will guide you and gain trust that you can do it yourself, and you don't have to have the knowledge of art to be curious and to learn about art. You already have a set of eyes, you already have your own life experience, and with that, it's already a starting point to get courage, to discover the other one or the artist and learn more. So that's in everything what we do. We put you as a visitor in the first place. I think that's the main focus. Just a small summary, we put the visitor first in everything we do, and our collection is focused on food. We really thought of, when we were building a new museum, that we were obliged to do something different from all other museums that already exist. And in our opinion, we have this freedom to do something different and put the visitor first instead of putting the artworks first, in the hope and in our mission in the end that the artist become the most important, or the arts become the most important. But we want to start with the courage and a broaden audience. So thank you.
Thank you, Sitske. I'm very happy to have you here presenting. And I will mention a couple of things in the context of this program. On the one hand, Sitske came to visit us just when you were opening the museum. And it was part of, or the visit that you made to our institution was one visit in many other visits that you were doing to other institutions to learn about how we programmed, how we organized. And soon after, we coincided again as part of a jury of the NN Award of Art Rotterdam. And at that time, it was the conversation, this is before COVID, just before COVID, and the conversation everywhere was about Mauricio Catalan's banana artwork. Can you just, do you remember this kind of scandal? For those that don't, maybe you can just mention a bit, because I know that you were involved and learned about that, and was a work that you all considered for your collection. Can you describe just a little bit about that? Because it was quite a funny moment, certainly pre-COVID, but I think also gets a, we get a sense of the kind of conversations that are had within your institution acquisitions.
Yeah, we were very interesting in purchasing the banana of Mauricio Catalan, and there was a big, well, there were, I think everybody had an opinion about it. Is this art, or is it like the clothes of the king in the story, that it's the whole bubble and it has nothing to do with art and it all has to do with power and money? But in a way, I think for us, this was, if you go out on the streets and you will ask someone, do you know an artwork, or do you know anything about art, or mention a name or something, I think nobody will be able to, or hardly anybody will be able to name an artist or name an artwork that was in, is important or will resonance in their mind. But this was a work that everybody was talking about it. If you liked it or not, everybody was having an opinion about it. And I think that's the bridge you want to make with the broad audience, because art is part of life, and it shows the discussion, and it presents us how economics function, or how corporates institutions function. So it is representing, and it puts a mirror in front of us how life works. So even a thing like a banana taped on the wall, which you can think anything about it, that it's just a hoax or whatever. He did it, and he can do it because he's Maurice Catalan. I can do it. If I would do it, it wouldn't mean anything. So you need the artist to make statements like that and to open up discussion.
It was during Art Basel in Miami, I believe, yeah. Right? The discussion. Yeah. So what I find interesting is that instead of having thought that one would go for a safer, more beautiful artwork, you would go for the controversial artworks to actually make that bridge with the public, which is one of the things that this discussion is aimed at. I personally find that that ready-made artworks, even though since Duchamp they have been the point of discussion for power and politics and for institutional work, meaning the ready-made really points at the structure of institutions and their power relations. I find that most recently it has been the ready-made artworks and that lineage that has created most of the discontent and, in fact, most of the critique of the arts from the general public that are unversed or not introduced to the history of the avant-garde as we know it from Western Europe, in which a work of critique suddenly becomes a hoax where the public that is not invested in the arts feels damned, no? So I kind of think that if you are going to think of the ready-made today in such a work, it's interesting to think about it in terms of public controversy. Is there any other work, since all the images also seem so amenable and so relaxed, everyone feeling trust, is there any other work in your collection that has also made a discussion around controversy and the importance of using controversy as a bridge to the public?
Yes, there. I think that we have the chocolate sculptures of Renzo Martens, which in it starts for the public as a it's a sculpture, and then they realize it's made out of chocolate, and then they hear the story about the plantages, the chocolate, and the Unilever. So it has a whole different story from the starting point, which is just a sculpture, and you like it or not. But so we have a few works that have this layer, but they need to have like steps, or you need to have, it's the same with the Yinka Shonibara work we have with The Last Supper. People are attracted to it because of its colors and because it seems nice and festive, like a big party, and then they realize it's more than just a party. It has a, maybe it puts something religious up to speak, and it also plays with power. And then you have these different layers to the work. So for us, it wouldn't be good to have an artwork that immediately pushes the boundaries. There need to be layers. Yeah.
I'm unaware, I know the work of Renzo Martin, but not specifically the one that you're mentioning. Could you please describe it so that we get a sense of what the work looks like, what it is about, and understand a little bit more of the controversy?
There are three self-portraits made out of clay by the former Plantage employees. So they're amateur artists supported by Renzo Martens to make art. And his whole idea of making these artworks was from the gentrification idea of that art would gentrificate an area and make the area more wealthy, or it would gain from money perspective. So he wanted in these spots where Unilever earned their money from, and in Western Europe, they would show it in Tate Modern or in big spaces and show how they were involved with art. But the spaces where they earned their money from were just ripped apart in a way. Nobody got any money from there, and he wanted to give it back by let them making, that they were becoming the artist, and that it would really earn the money that they supposed to earn. So there's a whole storyline in that, from these amateurs making art, showing in the white cubes, white spaces of the established art market, and really playing with this kind of value, what's worth, what's art, what's not art, kind of thing.
So I'm gonna now ask some questions to Marie, but it's interesting also as we discuss right now the current war in Ukraine and the ways in which one of the main discussions has been also food and the lack of circulation of some of the food. I mean, of course, everyone discusses gas and oil and the different sanctions, but we have a main discussion right now around the circulation or the stop of even oil, no, sunflower oil, and how do you call it in English? Harina? ¿Cómo se dice?
Wheat
and all these other products, food products. So maybe we will see some works in your collection that also deal with the current war and how wars in general have had an impact on food circulation and consumption, particularly in the global south, things that we wouldn't have known. But before continuing to talk about lamb, I wanted to ask some questions to Marie. Both of you have talked about your interest in public engagement, and this is for sure our interest as well as an institution. Everyone takes very different strategies. We just heard about the importance of trust or building trust with an audience, that's at the seed of the institution. And the view coach is a figure that the LAM Museum has used as a main kind of mediator between arts and the public. You know? So it's not even the institution as such, but actually a person that is the one mediating and bringing people closer in a very kind of Paulo Freire way, you know, that people already have the knowledge and the experience and have their senses to trust to be able to unpack a work that they're experiencing. What are some of the strategies that that the institution, whether in San Francisco or in Paris, uses also for public engagement? I know that events and event-based activities are the ones that we use as a conversation to, or as an opportunity or platform to socialize our experiences and our ideas surrounding the arts. What are some of the ways, if not the view coach, that Kadist has been using in the last number of years?
That's a good question, and I like the figure of the view coach. I hadn't thought about it this way. There's a couple of strategies that we've been thinking about. I think the question of mediation for us is important also, like in the way of like creating a bridge. For example, in San Francisco and Paris, we have a gallery associate that's here, that's someone who would be the same person for a couple of exhibitions that are also involved in the making of the exhibition and the production of the work. So they're also very aware of the in and out, so being able to share details in a very personal manner as well. So it's like the contact, the personal contact with the audience is also important. I think the size of the institution, staying intimate, is also a big strategy. Like it's easier to perhaps like enter in a space where you would recognize the people, you would recognize the space, you can feel also welcome and almost at home somehow. We have created, for example, for events, though now less so with COVID, because we can't really have a lot of public gatherings, but before every talks, we had like an hour of happy hour, so we were serving cocktails and drinks, being able to like chat and like really being able to bring this kind of feeling of being comfortable and to be here with friends, to be able to hear about art and artists. Something also we've been thinking about for events has been creating like a group, or staying like an intimate size of group without a stage or a mic. So everything is on the same level. You can be almost no distinction between the speakers and the audience. So it becomes a little bit of a more intimate circle. So like the couple of ways that we're we've been thinking about mediation in terms of art, trying to be, I think it can be, as you were saying, quite intimidating for audiences to come in an art space. So also really trying to think about that and how we can kind of maybe try as much as possible to break a little bit that vision of art and arts institutions. So, yeah.
And one of the things that we learn also from Sitske's presentation, whether it's of Renzo Martin's work or of the Maurizio Cattelan, is that controversial works or works that are controversial are a bridge between the public and an arts institution, or to think of what does art do in terms of opening public discussion, public debate, and very strong emotions, I should say. What are some of the questions that are a driving or a thematic that emerge in the acquisitions or in some of the artworks? Are there Edgate-ist specific themes that are of contemporary nature, that are controversial, that are addressed within your collection as well?
I don't think we necessarily look at controversies necessarily as a bridge. I think it also depends on where the work is presented. Like, it can be controversial in one context and not another. I think the driving forces for the collection and the program is really to think about themes that are relevant in a specific context, a region, or even globally, to create these connections. So we try through like the collections and also the programs to create a bridge like this. So if you feel connected to an artwork, perhaps for its history or how it's relevant to your personal or even your context, a national political context, that creates a link that maybe open up conversation. And our hope is to be able to create these discussions across different contexts. So being able to bring either artists to San Francisco of Paris or vice versa, like trying to bring the work, their work in other contexts to create these conversations around art and the issues in their work. Not so much about controversy as echoing.
So for example, right now we are in here in the Netherlands, the Koken, which is a tulip. Everyone goes there to see the tulips bloom. And the discovery of the Koken parts, meaning of the 15th century history, really anchors the institution both thematically and geographically where it is. And in the case of Kadist, the two venues, first in Paris and then in San Francisco, are more linked to the founders' homes. How is it then that the institution really globalizes? Tell us a little bit about the emergence of an office in China, for example, and one in Mexico, two very different contexts, and again, presenting not so much the, no longer, the biographical or thematic relationship, say, between the institution's public space and immediate audience at the home base, but in countries afar from like Mexico and China. What was the decision for those countries? What does it mean to hold offices there?
It was important for us to think about how we can responsibly work within different contexts. And since the very beginning, collaboration has been very key for us. Like, everything we do is in collaborations with different actors, so collectors or curators, institutions. And it was very important also at the moment where we started thinking about cross-cultural exchange in different ways, like how we can also facilitate that further, important to perhaps remove ourselves, like the venues themselves, from that equation. So being able to have someone on the ground who would know the context very well, being able to develop the programs and relationships meaningfully within the region was important. So that's why we thought about kind of opening offices. And when we say offices, it's not really, there is not a brick and mortar space with an actual office. It's more agents on the ground that are here and able to be conducting these conversations and these programs. So we thought about Mexico and China, Mexico thinking about also the connections and the personal relationship that we're having, same with China. We were having a lot of programs already in the regions, and it felt really key to be able to be there to develop and nurture these conversations there. So we also work really closely with all our advisors that are all over the world. So it feels like they're also agents on the ground representing the institution and leading these conversations. So it's kind of how it worked out, like how I developed thinking about relationships a lot.
I want to remind the public, oh yes, we already have a question, great. Yes, that I want us to have a conversation here with our speakers. It's a great opportunity to be able to ask questions with people that we wouldn't generally be looking at. Yeah?
Hi, I have a question about the education part for Siska maybe, because I know at Catalyst in San Francisco, a lot of the education also comes from the work itself. I remember the feminist school of teaching was, and I know at Melly that also happens a lot. Is that sometimes ever, you work with few coaches, but do you also sometimes work with artists for the education programming or the conversations? So where art and education kind of meets one another?
Yes and no. No, I think we make our own educational programs for educating the VUE coaches, as many of them don't have any art background. Most of them don't have any knowledge themselves, and they vary from 16 years of age up to 66 years of age, and we really want to represent them from the visitors or the audience that we have. And they, their main goal or their main skill that they should have is that they communicate. They have good communication skills. But for our audiences, we really focus on schools and secondary schools and higher education. So we're open on the Thursdays, especially for schools. So the museum is not open for a regular audience. It's just the school, so that the kids that are in our museum really feel at ease and have this feeling of trust for themselves to explore the collection. And for higher education, we sometimes have programs with artists and talks, but then they're mainly for art students or art schools, but not for our normal audiences. For now we don't make special programs or events in this matter, because we say the museum itself and the contact you have with the VUE coaches, that's the baseline and that's the first thing, and there are so many other good institutes where you can go further if you are interested into the arts.
I just ask, at the depot here we're working with also people who just live in the city and are interested in art but don't necessarily have like an art history background, to kind of have these mediated tours with people, and we're also just thinking of how to work with artists maybe also for them as a training to get a different point of view that doesn't come from us telling them a story or like lecture. So it's kind of
I think that's the most difficult balance to find, because on one way we really like to educate them and give them all these stories from us and from the artists as well. But I think the problem is when they have more knowledge, they want to share that knowledge and they start giving lectures instead of asking the questions. And we really want, we always say that the audience has the knowledge. So we also have people that are educated within arts and let them talk, let them tell their knowledge to you and give this knowledge to the other visitors. And I really like it when different group of visitors start to share knowledge together. And I think I absolutely agree with you, but the difficult balance to find is that they're not start to lecture themselves, because that's the thing. If they have the knowledge, the thing you like to do is to start. Instead of asking questions, giving answers.
Yeah, thank you.
I find it quite interesting because it's a question of pedagogy. No? In the public programs that are organized here, many of which are developed conceptually and practically by Vivian, the programs are for an adult and expert audience in most cases, and it is about sharing expertise and such. But then there's a whole other set of programs that the institution does, and one in particular that uses a pedagogy that is shared between two other institutions. So Kunstinstituut Melly Tent and Showroom Mama. And the pedagogy, it's called an initiative 100% contemporary, and it actually takes this point of departure as well, the Paulo Freire version, in which the audience that is participating, primarily schools, are giving a tool, a set of materials and tools for them to identify what kind of artist, and not so much what kind of artwork we're looking at in terms of genre or technique, or the bigger questions that the artwork may have within the process or on exhibition. And instead, it's based on the artwork, but the kind of artist that they imagine made the artwork in terms of a kind of approach to life, to the world, whether the artist is rebellious or a thinker, a rational, no? And I think that there are so many interesting pedagogies that, depending on the audience, you could apply or create in order to instigate participation. Now, moving a little bit about, less about the audience, but certainly still around questions around public engagements and institutionality. You began talking about, Sitski, that the foundation itself of Van der Broek actually was already invested in philanthropy, sponsoring existing institutions and participating in the cultural life of them through the philanthropic rather than the collecting side of their own interests. I want to get a sense of, from both Katist and from Lam, what is your relationship to philanthropy as institutions? And I ask this question because just before I came to work here to Kunstinstituut Melly, I worked for many years in a foundation that built a private collection and that was very adamant in not replicating institutional work that was out there. So the family, the Cisneros family, and specifically the head of it, Patricia Felipe Cisneros, was adamant in not creating a museum that would house their collection, but instead in creating a series of networks and partnerships where her philanthropic investment financially would help support existing institutions, whether that was the Reina Sofia, the MoMA, or others, and also people that were interested in doing research, the focus being Latin America for that foundation. And that the collection, the afterlife of the collection from the family would then be housed and cared for those institutions. So for them, building the collection was a way of, and opening it to the public, particularly to arts professionals, was for them to come and identify the works that would make their collections at their museums stronger. So very different position than creating their own institution with their own collection. So I want to get a sense a little bit about the move from this philanthropic position to one of the building your own museum, and also of Katist, the way in which the collaboration, whether it's with artists that I understand, and residencies, you commission work. I was honored to be in a residency there many, many years ago, in the first couple of years that the institution started. It was a very important supportive mechanism, so one could say the commissions are part of a philanthropic work, and we'll hear about that a little bit more in the next program. But give me a little bit of your own experiences and the internal discussions that may be there around institutionality and support collection and philanthropy, and the way in which your institution is part of an ecosystem, but not necessarily supports an existing one, right? Was I clear in the question?
Yeah. I think, speaking for our foundation, the most important part is that they wanted to support, or they will, and they still do support existing institutes, but, well, the lack of influence is what made them want to build their own public space. So,
what do you mean by the lack of influence?
They really had an idea, or they really have this big urge of building an institute that is open for a different audience. And that specific part, they couldn't find an existing institute that matched with their drive to build something new. So they really searched for institutes where they could help and that would fit for a part of their wishes and their focus of stimulating art for young people and or making art or music. So those are the institutes that we still support and will support. But there was always this extra idea and feeling that they want to do and want to make, and they couldn't find an existing place. So that's why they really said, okay, we want to build something our own, and if we do that, we don't want to, what you say, replicate what's already there, but we really want to use this white sheet of making something that doesn't exist and where we can go over boundaries where the existing institutes cannot do that because of the government payments or all the other influences that for them it's not able to do the things that we do, like that we focused on these, that everybody is employed, we don't work with volunteers, and our focus is like this direct contact with people, and we don't have an amount of people that we want to have in our museum, so we keep the amount of ticketing low, so we can have this personal contact. And there is no institute in the Netherlands that could do that, because all institutes are you have to count how many people are in there, because that's then you get paid. And for us, it's no, we don't want a lot of people, but everybody that's in, we want to make an impact. So that's why we choose to make our own institute or build our own institute. Okay. Yeah.
Mary, tell us, I mean, you're not the yeah, tell us, you have a... tell us about that relationship around, I mean, also France has, you know, a number of institutions as well, you know, that are privately owned. I mean, it's, yeah, tell us a little bit about that relationship between philanthropy and institutionality in the ecosystem.
Yeah, first, it's also interesting because CADIS is also related to another philanthropy organization that's not necessarily involved in the arts, but more thinking about direct support to different organizations. So it feels very much part of the DNA of what we do. We do that perhaps in the arts context. I think perhaps one of them is through this collaboration, so how we can also support an ecosystem and this really network of urgencies within different with different institutions, and being able to create these networks of conversation, helping also support the artists and the research that's important in different regions. So with definitely the residencies are one way to really accompany an artist or curator or even an art space. We've started a couple of years ago programs where we invite an art space to be in residence. And what does that mean for an art space to be coming to another context and think about how to translate or kind of bring awareness around some of the context or the art scenes themselves? It kind of goes on very different levels. Also thinking about locally in San Francisco and Paris, the role that the spaces have within the ecosystem of the cities as well is important. And we keep reinventing themselves and trying to think about what's really urgent and needed. So it goes in different. It's hard not to think about philanthropy in some ways because it's so much part of everything.
I think it's interesting that you point out that that CADIS is one of a number of foundations that that the family has, and that it's perhaps through other foundations that direct support is most evident in the kind of direct way of what we understand as philanthropy. I have to say that. Having had the experience of that residency, which I think was almost 15 years ago, but also knowing that a number of my peers and colleagues that are independent curators or institutional curators that are part perhaps of the advisory team and also the artists that do residencies, that one could also think that that type of activity is philanthropic to the extent that the honorariums or the commissions go to directly support their, you know, creative process and their professional trajectory or artistic trajectory. No.
I'm so happy that we've reached this question, because I think it's really sort of the pointy edge of the pointy edge of the wedge, let's say. And there's certainly a very lively conversation here in the Netherlands, because it's quite a specific philanthropic context. So there's a very active conversation in terms of the role of philanthropy in relation to institutions and state support, the need for institutions to have direct support where the state has been withdrawing for some years. So I think it's quite exciting, and I think you've both articulated a very strong awareness of where your institutions sit within the field and within ecosystems. And my question concerns knowledge exchange. Sietske, clearly there's some really interesting experiments taking place with the VUE coaches and with what it means to engage new audiences, which we also have been very active in, and which are very interesting from the experiments that we've been taking. I wonder if you found if there are any points within the field here to exchange knowledge, or if there's been interest from the state institutions in relation to what you've been doing. And same for Cadiz, have you found that there are points of knowledge exchange with either other foundations or other collections, or with state institutions in France or elsewhere?
I feel that discussions and relationship are so important in this context. Like, knowledge exchange is definitely key in some way, and sometimes it happens in ways that we don't even realize it. I think part of also what we do, like definitely that's part of the pandemic that was really hard for the institution, because things that we were perhaps taking for granted or kind of were happening organically through different encounters had to be rethought entirely. Starting to kind of maybe go back to it somehow, but definitely the world has changed. So how do we continue these endeavors and facilitating those exchange? So I don't know if we really found solutions, really, relying a lot on having conversations even online, but kind of all the personal, interpersonal questions around cultural exchange is very difficult. So there's definitely a lot of interest in trying to still facilitate that. I think that's part of the tools that we keep developing, using or trying to leverage technology is definitely perhaps part of that, but we still like really open to ideas if there is a lot of, if there are ideas.
Yeah, I think for us it's a bit the same. Yes, we do cooperate, and there's a lot of institutes that come and visit and learn from the things that we are doing or are experimenting in the Netherlands, but also abroad. We had some, because we had it during the COVID period, we launched the VUE phone, which was an old-fashioned phone call with people all around the world that could just call us, and we would talk about an artwork that was in front of us with no visuals, so no images, just a talk about 50 minutes. And we were talking to people from Pakistan to Canada to the Netherlands, which was wonderful, and because it was just this personal direct contact. And we had some international museums that wanted to do the same thing later on during the COVID period. So, yeah, it's great to cooperate and work together. But the real, holy grail, how to do work together or learn from each other, I think it hasn't been really discovered yet. So if you know, let me know.
No, I think it's interesting, all these things. Now, I want to go back to the question around institutionality. And one of my favorite museums in the world, actually, happens to be in the Netherlands, of contemporary art, which is the Van Abbe Museum in Eindhoven. And I love the museum for how it has been, at least for the last decade, really thinking of curating their collection in quite unique ways. And by that I mean is they know that the collection is very particular. It was created, by a family, by a man specifically, and now is the city's collection. The Van Abbe Museum is actually the city museum. And they really activated quite beautifully in different ways. So even if the collection lacks contemporaneity, or even if the collection doesn't have perhaps the masterpieces, they have been able to create narrative after narrative that makes it useful and relevant as a collection to understand not only perhaps the artists and their times when they were creating the work, but what it means to think of art today at present. Most of the questions are contemporary of our times, even if the collection is 100 years old. And I mentioned this because that private collection that was donated to the city and that eventually became the municipal, the stedelijk kind of Eindhoven, is a way in which we generally tend to experience private collections, meaning when they are public. What are some of the ideas that have already been discussed, perhaps, around succession within your own family-owned collections? What will happen with these collections when the family passes away, remain under a trust that runs the institutions independently? Or has there been discussion of a time period where these institutions will run and then eventually pass to be administered by a city or by another museum? Is there ideas around bequests? So I think that, again, institutionality, and right now in the Netherlands, there is much discussion about bequests that could be done of artworks, but of course of property and of estates of different kinds. So can we hear a little bit about the ways in which, if traditionally private collections were donated full on to museums or to cities to establish museums, what are some of the ideas that are future related or future proof? That's a very trendy bad word, but we like to use it here around questions of sustainability. So what are some of the future proof ideas of succession, bequests, or institutionality trusts that you have been discussing?
Yeah, for us, it's very timely questions because we've been thinking about it for the long term. And at the moment, maybe things will change, but at the moment, the hope is that there would be another organization or trust that would be responsible for the collections and making it accessible. So the conversation has been more around how we can make the collection as a resource that's available and that could be supported with different funds to other organizations in different, perhaps, contexts that may not have access to this specific type of work. So instead of donating it, for example, to a museum or a city, it would be thinking about where the collection can be seen, because part of I think for all institutions, storage is a big question. A lot of the collection stays in storage and is not accessible. So how we can facilitate access to art. So that's the thought at the moment, is it would be that.
Mm-hmm. A trust.
Yeah, I think for us it's kind of same. We have a trust, or we build a trust, so we can, there's no thinking for now to donate it in the future. The structure now is that it's in a trust for the upcoming 50-100 years, but it will, of course, everything's end, will have an end, so maybe in a but in a way we are too young actually now to be at a stage already further, so for the close by future, the next 50-100 years, the structure is a trust fund. Yeah. Okay.
Well, that's still a lot of time, which we like it. One of the presenters that would have joined us today was Ines Katzenstein, the director of the Cisneros Institute. And it was also in light to understand how Patricia Phelps actually donated her work. And one thing that I would like to mention there, because it relates to this, is that the donation of artworks, for example, to the Museum of Modern Art, came with a large millions and millions of dollar gift that created a pocket within the museum itself so that collection could be actively researched and activated through publications, exhibitions, programming, fellowships, and so on. So the trust was actually established within the institution to secure the positions and the funding that would constantly activate the collection that had been donated because it was hundreds of works, so that it didn't stay within the storage, or that it didn't stay just as a gift that was not addressed in terms of content. So, are there any other audiences that would like to ask questions? We have some more minutes. Yes?
It's been quite a lot of information for me. I'm visiting the Netherlands for the first time from South Africa, and it's amazing to me the diversity of the institutions that are here, as well as the different levels of engagement. So I just wanted to say thank you for all your different viewpoints and illuminating such a diverse range of subjects.
Thank you. And it's interesting that you're coming from South Africa. Welcome to the Netherlands. Mm-hmm. And to Rotterdam, which is a kind of very cosmopolitan city, very particular in Europe. One thing, we have been looking at a couple of institutions in South Africa, actually, that are new. And we're looking at them because very interesting curators have come to direct them. So now Koyo is directing a private museum. And I find that quite interesting. So a curator that has been generally associated with local practices, very much bottom-up structures, has chosen to direct a museum that's a private collection. And I think that different from Europe or Western Europe, to be specific, in many other countries, specifically in the Global South, it is institutionality is built through individuals and not governance, not governments generally, no? Absolutely. Yeah, and another institution that I find quite interesting, and again, I arrived to it through the work of curatorial minds, Gabi Nagobo, is now also directing an institution that a big museum with very interesting materials and so on, and what I understand is that it's a private collection that opened a cultural center within a university campus, and so also in South Africa, leading the way into new institutions. I like it very much. I have yet to go, but I'm dying to go there. That's why I'm checking on the institutions. Very interesting people. We had an exhibition here of Usha Sijarim, curated by Tumelo Mosaka, and from South Africa both, and unfortunately unable to travel here because of the pandemic.
Yeah.
But our heart is very much palpitating there. No?
Collecting the international and the local has been definitely a theme, I think, of this program and the two guests that we've had, which often happens through philanthropy and collecting. So I think that's the end then of this program. Thank you so much to our guests for the program, to our audience for being here, to our audience online. Yeah. Hand of applause. And I think we'll be back in 1 hour.
Yeah, I think that half hour, no?
Okay. Half hour, we'll be back online and in the room.
Yeah. So stay around in the neighborhood if you want to join us for the next program with the presenters, or come and see our exhibitions upstairs and have a coffee so that we can be part of the next program, hopefully. Yeah. Yeah.
Good afternoon, and welcome back to Kunstinstituut Melly. Once again, I'm Vivian Zahol. I'm the Research and Programs Manager here at Kunstinstituut Melly for our day today on collecting in conjunction with Art Rotterdam, which commenced on Wednesday and is continuing here through the weekend, and which we always love to participate in. And one of the ways that we participate with Art Rotterdam is through the presentation of our edition, which is an annual fundraiser that we have. This year, the edition is by the artist Simon Fujiwara, who was part of our program last year, with his exhibition and ongoing artistic research and expression called Who the Bear. So in conjunction with our director, Sofia Hernandez-Chonghui, Simon has developed a new artwork called A Whole New Who, Bedtime Reading. You can see an image of it up here. You can see a live version in the room with us here as well. Or if you go to Art Rotterdam, you'll find one in our booth and you'll be able to purchase one. Also, they can be purchased online. The work came from the exhibition, which is an interrogation of identity through the fictional character of a bear, which is a riff on the Pooh the Bear identity, who had a somewhat confused gender identity. Of course, for us at the time, this was very relevant because we were going through our own identity crisis as an institution with our renaming, moving from the former name to our current name of Kunstinstituut Melly. The work within the solo presentation that Simon made, Who the Bear took many guises, Who the Bear was a figure in art history, Who the Bear was a figure in populist politics, and here we have a more intimate relationship with Who the Bear, with the bedside reading table. So it's an artwork that I think would go beautifully in a children's bedroom or in an adult's lounge room. it's selling for 1,200 euros, excluding BTV and excluding framing. We do have framed copies with the beautiful yellow frame. And yeah, please be welcome to support us. We appreciate it very, very much. We've done very well this year as well with a lot of interest in it. So I think we might commence the program then. So the afternoon component of the program is focused on the ethics of collecting and a conversation around a code for ethical collecting, which is, of course, a very large area within the field of contemporary art. The markets for contemporary art have transformed over the last decade, and yet some of the conversations around what that transformation is are yet to catch up. So we really look forward to hearing more about this. The guests for the program will be Yordanis Karanidis, Piero Giorgio Pepe, Sandra Turgeman, and the program will be moderated by Alexander Ramsalar, who is the chairperson of the COCA Award. And at 5 p.m. today, please be welcome to join us for a tour of the current edition of the COCA Award, which we are very happy to host upstairs with the curator Ellis Katz and the artist Nokokanya Langer. So for the next hour, we'll be talking about the ethics of collecting. Please be welcome to the stage, our guests. And Alex, I'll hand it to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Vivian, for introducing us. Well, till about 2 o'clock, we will be discussing about the ethics of collecting. The program for today is that first you will get an introduction by the participants who were in fact the founders of this code. And after that will be about 20, 30 minutes, we're going to have about an hour to discuss with each other about the code of this code. So hopefully we have a very fruitful discussion with it, look to the aspects of it. So I think that it's going to be an interesting 1.5 hours. First, I want you to let you introduce yourself, so maybe we can go now, we'll go that way.
Does it work? Yeah. Okay, thanks. So very briefly, I guess. My name is Sandra Turgeman. I'm the co-founder of CADIST. That was discussed this morning as well, which is a collecting entity or institution where the program is based on the collection. But I'm also the founder of two other organizations that are artistically based but very socially driven, called Council and Afield. And I'm part of the Essex of Collecting, thanks to you guys.
Hi, my name is Yordanis Kerenidis. I am a research director at the University of Paris. I work on quantum computing that has not much to do with art, but I'm here today as a collector. Together with Pier Giorgio, we have been collecting for more than 15 years ago. And you know, from the beginning, we started trying to understand what it means to be a collector, or what it doesn't mean to be a collector, and how we can fit or not fit into, you know, the role of collecting. And this is kind of how we started discussing what would it mean to maybe think of a more ethical way of collecting. And we started this group that culminated after a year and a half on this code of collecting, code of conduct for collecting that we will be discussing. And thanks for having us here.
Okay, so thank you for the invitation. My name is Pier Giorgio Pepe, and by background, I'm a lawyer. I worked in the city for many years in London as a lawyer, and then I moved to the pharmaceutical industry, where I worked as ethics officer in the barricades for a good part of 20 years. And then more recently, I'm an ethics and consultant advisor. I also teach a university, Sciences Po in Paris, business ethics, but also ethics in the art sector. And I've been collecting with Yordanis for a good part of, 16 years now. And yes, I was a little bit the technical hand of this code, if I may say, because of my background, I wouldn't say as a lawyer, more like as an ethics officer for a good part of 20 years. So I was able to help out with more the kind of practical drafting and thinking from a technical side. But I was really happy because we have a very diverse group that brought so much, and there was a lot of storytelling.
Maybe we can name them, no? Yeah. What do you think?
Yes, absolutely. Do you want to name it?
Okay. Help me. Exactly. I'm just going to put the first name, Evrim and Jessica. I'm just, the group of, we are eight co-writers, and the goal is to enlarge this group and to welcome more collectors who want to write the code in the future. But the eight first who committed, so Evrim and Jessica, who are based in New York, Haro Sumbunsian, who's based in between Zurich and Istanbul, André Zivanari, who's based in Cyprus, you guys, Pedro Barbosa, who's in Brazil, and who else?
Oh, this is it.
Voilà.
Yes.
Yeah, maybe you can tell a bit more about the backgrounds of setting up this this code. What did lead that?
Yes, so, you know, first of all, why a code of conduct for collectors, right? So we've been thinking about that, and there's a number of reasons why we came to the conclusion that we wanted to draft one. First of all, is really to reinforce the positive role. You know, so we really start from a positive role, reinforcing our positive role of collectors. We've had that supportive role for centuries, right? So how can that role, now facing the current ethical challenges that our world is questioning, how can we bring also our role to the level of discussion and question ourselves? You know, if you take some of the practices that happen in our art world, and if you check the same in other sectors, these are very problematic, right? So what we do in other sectors, actually people will go to prison sometimes. I'm thinking about insider trading or, you know, conflict of interest. For us, it's almost, they're almost celebrated, while in other sectors, they're very directly condemned. And so there were big gaps in terms of a difference between other public interest sector, because one of the premise of the code is art is a public interest. And if you look at health, if you look at transport, if you look at energy, other sectors that have direct public interest, they have very specific rules to avoid conflict of interest, to avoid corruption, to avoid undue influence, to avoid any other, you know, ethical matters. And in our sector, there are some codes, but from the collecting side, not so much. And if you think about the power structure, where usually you do ethical rules to contain the powerful part, And the powerful part seemed to be the one that was less sort of, for which there were fewer standards, in this case, collectors. So one of the objectives of the code is also to readdress the power balance. So that's really where we come from. But what is the code? Well, the code is not compulsory. It's more like a manifesto. We chose the word code because we wanted to give some gravity to it. But it's not compulsory because we're not an institution. We're not elected people. We cannot impose on anybody. It would be actually utterly authoritative, sort of, I would say, authoritarian to say, okay, now all collectors must comply with it. But it's more like a food for thought for people and voluntarily comply with it and adhere with it. So I want to make very sure it's not, nobody's going to go to prison if they don't follow the code. At the same time, we hope in peer-to-peer enforcement in the sense that people see others behaving in a certain way and they may show the code and say, look, have you thought about this? This is a code. Maybe you didn't think about it, but there's another way of doing that. So that's what the code is about, really. It's a voluntary set of rules. It will be reviewed very frequently. We hope at least once a year, but not more frequently, not to destabilize people. You know, rules have to have a certain stability. So, but every year, and we welcome really that everybody, to collectors or institutions, artists, to contribute and to provide feedback that you could leave on the website, and we will take all feedback very seriously. Of course, to whom it's addressed? It's addressed to collectors, right? And it's written by collectors as an act of self-regulation, as I said, to counterbalance the power that we may have. And codes of conduct are generally written by people in that specific category. You don't write code for others. Again, that would be authoritarian. That's why it's called by collectors for collectors. It does, to some extent, challenge also the vision of collecting as, how can I say, sometimes we're talking about the image of the public as of art, right? And sometimes very distant and elitist, right? So we want to also, I wouldn't say challenge that role, but challenge the normative role of the collector as a capricious passion, you know, sometimes has been very wrongly portrayed in the past, and actually show that there are collectors, they are publicly engaged, that believe that we have a role helping the public interest, supporting the creative process without unduly influencing it, right? So key principles in the code, as I mentioned earlier on, the premise is that art is a public interest, and those that own artworks, therefore, it's not like owning a jar, it's owning something which is of public interest, and therefore they have to have responsibilities towards the artwork, towards their creators, towards their environment, towards the institutions that make the art visible and possible, right? So we do have duties, because whenever you have a public interest, that has to be protected, right? So, but what you will find in the code is that we didn't use the language of institutional critique. We used the language of business ethics, because that's where the gap was. There's hundreds of very interesting articles on IFLAX and others on ethical issues in the art. There was no need for us to enter that space, but really bring from other sectors those specific standards that we believed were missing from a collecting perspective. So that's the thought process. Of course, the code is inspired by principles like anti-corruption, conflict of interest, avoiding unfair communication. And it's articulated around two dynamic. The first dynamic is directly self-regulating our actions. So collectors, for example, pay artists when they engage them for services. Yes. But also indirect advocacy, saying collectors, if an institution, for example, asks for a loan of artwork for a solo show, and we realize that the artist is not going to get paid by that institution for the solo show, then in conversation with the artist, we may decide not to give the loan as a sign. So advocating for others to pay. So, of course, so these are the two dynamics. Either what we can or cannot do directly, or what we can do by influencing others. Right, so this is really the, and I'm talking a lot, but I just wanted to give you, and then, you know, if you look, as I mentioned, if you look at the way it's structured around chapters with interactions. So there's a chapter on a section on the interactions with artists, a chapter on the interaction with the collection, a chapter on commissioning artworks, a chapter relationship with institutions, a chapter relationship with the public and the media, a chapter relationship with galleries, and so on and so forth. And maybe just to give you a very brief overview of the artist one, as I said, the two key principle, the two key provisions, I think, in the artist sections is the one that when we do engage artists for services, presentations, installation work, whatever work, because one of the premises of this code, by the way, is that we're in an industry here, and work is work, and work needs to be paid. We're not a special sort of course, art is special, we all want to believe that, but at the same time, people work, and people need to get paid. And so we were in conversation with Wage the other day, because we're looking at how we, you're probably familiar with Wage, you know, in New York is this organization that looks after, well, there's publishing standards for remuneration of artists and other very important standards in the sector. And one thing they said very clearly, I said, people believe a lot of the abuse in this sector is because people believe that we're very special, so they don't apply the normal rules, like labor rules. You know, you work, you get paid. It's as clear as that. So that's one of the premises of the code. And that's why two of the articles in the artist section, as I said, it's about artists paying artists promptly and fairly, not soliciting artworks for free. We've seen so many private collections going to artists and saying, look, give me a work, you're going to get so much visibility. You know, you don't pay your bills with visibility. Visibility is not a currency. So really avoiding, stop asking for free artworks. If artists want to give us something for free, okay, we may consider accepting it, taking into consideration the consequences and implications of that. Then other, for example, advising artists in their interest. We've been advising artists forever, since the beginning of times, but it's time to really understand when we speak to them, are we really doing their interest, or are we protecting a collection? Are we pushing them to galleries which will make the prices go up so that also our own artworks will also be more valuable? So that kind of thinking, a sort of, you know, raising awareness around these questions that in our everyday conversations maybe we don't follow so much. And that, I think, you know, the other in parts of the code for artists talk about communicating respectfully, not to be condescending, not to be predatory, not to be dominating, just understanding we hold the position of privilege, we hold the position of power, and this, we need to be respectful towards others, essentially. And most of us are, by the way. It's, the code is just bringing all this nicely together as a reminder. Okay. Sorry.
Yeah.
That was a long introduction.
Maybe can I just add how it was done? Because maybe that helps. Pier Giorgio gathered, and Jordanis gathered, so this group of eight people. And for a year and a half, we met every month online and sort of started to share stories that we experienced, like situations that were a bit uncomfortable, that were probably full of conflict of interest. And through time, because we got to trust each other, we got to tell those stories to one another. So it was really it started as a self-reflection process that ended up into this very constructed tool. But I think this is important to bring the value of this code as a space of conversation that started among eight people, but hopefully will be a space for a larger group of collectors.
Yeah, and once we had some of the sections ready, for example, the ones that were discussing the interactions with the artists, then we shared the drafts of the code with the artists in order to get feedback back, and then also this changed the code itself, because we understood that maybe there were some issues that the artist would bring up that we had never thought about. So I think this is what was very interesting, that it's not so much that it's not clear that we should not be doing something and that we should be doing something, it's more that there are many things that don't even cross our minds sometimes, because we're just, no one has brought it up, right? And I think this is what came out of all this year and a half during COVID discussions, that we all come up with situations, we all, you know, deal with situations where there are some nuanced discussions that we need to have, right?
And what are the next steps? You already made a website, Ethics of Collection, so everybody can see it there. And how are you going to bring it into the world of the art world and the collectors specific? What are the next steps for you?
Yeah, the next steps, one of the next steps is to be in places like here, because I think it's extremely important to start a serious conversation with the institutions, right? You know, it's always interesting when you ask the institutions, what do you think of collectors? How is your relationship with collectors that are in the boards, with collectors that are in acquisition committees and all of these things? And I think part of the code has to also to do with that, that we want to have a seat on the table, but we want to have it for the right reasons, not because of, you know, the size of the check that we write, but because we actually are there and we have a common interest, and the common interest can only be the art and the artists somehow, right? So I think one of the first things that we're doing is that we are going to public forums, fora, whether it is in institutions. The first one, the first discussion was at ARCO, which is a fair. I think this is an interesting place to start talking about collecting, you know, when you are in an art fair, and there is a lot to discuss about art fairs as well. So we will continue this. We are, as Sandra was saying, we are expanding the circle, because we do want to have more and more collectors that actually bring their input, right? And they are starting themselves to embody the code, and the code should live outside the eight of us, right? There were many discussions as well. They were starting having discussions in South America in different fairs where none of the eight writers are there, but there are people that we have discussed with, that we had long conversations, and we trust them to be able to open a discussion with the people there on dealing with all this. We are discussing also with WAGE, and we want to continue discussing with other artists associations, because we also feel that artists themselves have to organize and have to fight for their rights, and we are there to listen to what they want and to figure out how we can help on our side, right? But again, as Pier Giorgio was saying, we cannot enforce anything, right? But we want to tell them, and this is one of the things that this code does, is we want to tell them that we are here to listen to what they need and try to change on our side how we deal as collectors with the artists.
Thank you. Yeah, no, maybe to add, I would say there's three, I was thinking at the same time, there's three directions. One is the advocacy, like today. So you have conversation, you go to talks, and you think, and you share these ideas and the drives behind. The other one is really tooling. So really thinking of it as a tool, but extending the toolbox. So artist contracts, commissioning contracts, like all these documents that can be useful for other collectors to manage their involvement. And the third one is this peer-to-peer conversation, so creating a larger movement, a larger conversation for just peer-to-peer exchange.
Well, thank you for this introduction. I think this is a good moment also to discuss this. And when Sophia asked me to moderate this, it brought me back to about 15 years ago. And I think Rijn van der Lucht, who was sitting there, was also at that event. We had a meeting with about 30 collectors. Wilfried Lentz, a collector here from Rotterdam, he was showing his collection in the Boijmans and asked works at his home back and opened his house for the public. And one night he invited about 30 collectors, and for me, I didn't know the art world at all, so it was a new evening for me, and experiencing also that more people had the same virus that I had. And it was really nice evening, talking together about shared passions, etc. At that moment, Charles X presented his plans for the depot building. And automatically, there was an urge that another collector said, I'm going to organize another meeting, because this was such a nice meeting. So 2 months later, we went somewhere in the forest near Utrecht. And we had a meeting, and it was nice, dining, talking. And all of a sudden, somebody rings the glass and said, I want to say something. And in the meantime, about 10 collectors had taken the initiative. And they say, should we not organize ourselves? Should we be an association? So if there are issues, that we have a voice. And all of a sudden, we had a big discussion about this, whether we should do that or not. And in fact, there were two camps, the 10 people who wanted to form that association. but about 20, and I don't know, Ryan, I don't know in which camp you were, who said, no, we don't want this. I mean, these meetings are there because we are intrinsically motivated to do it. And if somebody feels the urge to organize something like this, we will do that. And if there is an issue, we will find each other because we know each other. And one guy said he was in mergers and acquisitions, and he said, before we know it, in some years, there will be a code for collectors. And I really don't want that. The art world is the only free market where I can be myself, be more clever than other people, make deals, and have more information than other people. And when Sophia called me, I thought, whoa, it's not in 4 years, but in 50 years, now there is a code. And I think that's also a nice starting point for this discussion. And I also, of course, read the code. And for me, yeah, it felt like mirroring a lot of things that I thought, oh, yeah, I'm not doing that bad. And it also, yeah, hits the boxes of the things that we see in art life, and where also there are a lot of books about, like shock art and other books. But also in the last weeks, when I talked about this with other collectors, I got really different reactions, like people, oh, come on, not another code. We already have three codes in the Netherlands, like the governance code of culture, the fair practice code, code of diversity, more for the institutions. But another code, come on, I'm a citizen. I'm already being an ethic, I'm handling to that. And we have a constitution. And other people agreed, said, yes, this is good. It's good to reflect, it's good to... So I'm wondering if you go to the why question, it's there, but I'm also interested how you look to that.
Yes, it's definitely my job to ask the first question. But it just strikes me so much that this code comes out of the period of the lockdown and the period of quarantine and pandemic, which was a period of time of slowing down and of reflecting. It was also a period of time in which the art market was really interrupted because the fairs simply could not function according to their norms. Many of the art galleries also found that, in fact, they didn't need the fairs in the way that they thought they had, so there was this kind of change of consciousness. And I just wonder, in quite a broad way, about this code as maybe also trying to hold open a tempo of reflection or a space of reflection within the industry per se, and particularly, Alex, as you see it as almost like offering mirror effects, you know, even if there isn't implementation, at least some kind of zone of reflection.
Yeah, I think we all had this question of what will happen when things get back to normal, right? Like, also as collectors, would we just continue to go back to going to 10 fairs per year? And is this the main place where we will see the art? Or are we just going to realize a little bit also, you know, how to act in different scales, right? Go back also to some old local scales and smaller scales that I think during the pandemic, you know, we realized how also important they are, apart from traveling to Miami and to Hong Kong and to other places. So there are all these discussions that were quite interesting on whether there would be some change in the market, right? What would be the position of the artist or of the institutions in this new, let's say, COVID, after COVID era? I don't see much of a difference. I think we're going back to kind of where we were, and I think that's why we need to continue discussing all these issues. And going back to your point, I think we had exactly the same discussion. Even when we brought the group of eight people there, some of the initial discussions is, why do we need this, right? And do we need to become a regulated space as everything else? You know, shouldn't we be free to enjoy art and do as we like, because it's my money, I can spend it as I want, and that's the end of the story. So I think it's an extremely interesting discussion, and I think somehow the answer that we came up with is that the moment you get into a public role, whether by showing your art, whether by opening a foundation, whether by opening a museum, whether we are opening a museum just next to Melly, and saying to the people, come to me and not go to Melly, or, you know, at that point, I think we have to stop having the discussion of collecting as a private act or a private passion, right? We have to start discussing about what are the ethics of collecting, what are the responsibilities of something, because you are, you know, doing something for the public and with the public. And at that point, you start having responsibilities as any public institution has.
Yeah, but I also see, if you look at it, if you buy a work in the base, it's a private thing. But if you work and collaborate, if you show the work, you go in the public domain. And what I see in the Netherlands, a lot of institutions, they have to apply to different codes. You already walk into the field of the codes, and there you see also some overlap with this code.
Yes, I think you know, absolutely what Jordanis was saying, it becomes very evident that we need to have some standards when, as private collectors, we go public. That's, for me, it's, you know, if you go to, talking about Paris, and we're being recorded, but it's okay. Talking about Paris, you know, you have large institutions not very far from big museums, and the general public still not necessarily understand the difference between the two. And one has much larger resources and, you know, much larger also tax reductions and benefits. And the more tax reductions on one side, the less budget on the other, and people are confused, where do I go, and who has the power to decide what's important in art today? Is it a publicly elected, funded body, or someone that has a vision and a particular taste? You know, so all these discussions we had. And to your point, yes, artist is still a space of freedom, but we also came from the perspective that as collectors we enjoy a lot of power, because yes, our freedom has been traditionally freedom associated with economic power, right? And it's okay for a second to take a step back and say, maybe my freedom should withdraw a little bit and let institutions have more freedom, because we've seen many cases in which collectors pay to be on boards, and then they want to decide, or they want to show their collector their works from their collections, or artists. So yes, to person, to individual freedom, but that individual freedom comes with power, comes with privilege, comes with money, and it's okay for us to take a little step back and let others be more free, and that means also shutting up for a little bit more and controlling ourselves. So I'm being a little bit direct here, but it's also a bigger ethical question of my individual freedom. When I have the money, it doesn't mean that it becomes a playground. Yeah, this is not a playground. And I'm exaggerating to make a point. I'm not being, but sorry, do I make sense? Yeah?
Well, some of the questions that I had were already answered, but I mean, I had the feeling that lots of things changed in terms of the market during the two-year pandemic, and not necessarily that the market actually slowed down, but the feedback that I was receiving from a lot of gallerists was indeed that they were selling online a lot, that there was a different relationship that was developed between collector and artwork, and I thought that was quite interesting, and was wondering whether you were thinking about that when you were right. I mean, I followed the whole process of the code, of course. And the second question that I had was whether you were thinking of developing the code in relationship to this concept of the foundation, like when officially a collector indeed becomes public, but by having an institution. So possibly an ethics of instituting when it comes to collectors.
Whom?
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So the first question was
online sales.
Online sales. Yes. So, indeed, we have seen a difference, and the difference was maybe that it was more difficult to have interactions both with the artists, the galleries, and stuff. So somehow, I think what we saw is that we distilled these interactions to the ones that were important. And I think this was kind of the main difference of what happened. Instead of just roaming around and having not very deep conversations with 100 people, you know, you had to make a specific point in saying, you know, I want to talk to this artist, or I want to talk to this gallery after the online, you know, rooms and all of these things, and try to find different ways of connecting somehow, right? What I was saying before is that it's not clear to me what will happen once everything opens up again, right? If we will go back to how things were. Like one important thing that happened during the pandemic because of the absence of physical space and stuff was things like NFTs, right? And, you know, we can talk about NFTs, but at least everyone, I think, should agree that this is an insane thing that has been happening for the last couple of years. You know, aside questions about, you know, the content or how, if this art is important or not or anything like that, but, you know, you kind of see that art is a market very clearly when you say the moment that there was no possibility of spending money to that level physically or going to fairs, there was a new way that was found, you know, because to me it was just more important to spend the money than the art. And I think this is what comes out of this, right? And if this is the art market and how we are today, I really think that regulations is something that has to be there. Right, I don't think there is any question of between the freedom of being, you know, because of course most of the people, we trust each other, we don't need to sign contracts, we don't need to, you know, to do these things because we trust each other. You cannot leave it to that. It's as simple as that, you know. And you know, it was interesting. We were talking to a collector once, and an artist. Actually, we were talking to an artist, and the artist said, "I tried to make the collector sign a contract," and the collector said, "What do you mean? You don't trust me? I'm not signing anything." So I think we need to change the narrative. I think we need to understand where we are, what's happening, and the fact that, yes, I trust you, but and that's why I ask you to sign a contract, because then the person I don't trust would also have to sign a contract, and I will be protected. And the discussion between artists and collectors is the artists that have to be protected more. And again, it's not that all of the artists are the good guys and all of the collectors are the bad guys. That's not what, it's not what the code says. It's not about good people and bad people, right? It's about specific actions that you just have to think how to protect the vulnerable party in the interaction.
Just, shall I answer to the second question? Or the second being, is it really made for private individual collector who buy maybe for their house a few pieces, or is it made for collector who becomes, who starts institution like the one we saw this morning, or we discussed this morning, or like Catist? I think both, clearly, because, I mean, both in terms of, for the individual collectors, as soon as you wanna be part of the ecosystem, if you wanna be like a player, not only buying for your house, but also supporting artists in different ways, being in prizes or starting your own prize, being on the board, there's so many situations where it extends your private action. And you become public, enfin, you're part of a public, ecosystem, and this is why it all started. And I just wanted to add that I think the pandemic helped us gather and meet and be online like super rigorously, but it's really timely. It was necessary to do it today because also it reflects the evolution of artistic practices as being very, you know, politically engaged, socially driven, of art having a social impact. And therefore, the art cannot be a private bubble. It cannot be, you know, a state of exception or a space of freedom. It has a political and social implication. And therefore, this comes as a, you know, as a consequence.
But at the same time, if I look to the Dutch context, when you go public, when you collaborate with institutions or you set up an institution yourself, you already are in the field of other applicable codes that I just mentioned, like the fair practice, the governance code, culture, diversity. So is this code not more about what happens behind the scenes in the private relations you have as an artist or as a gallerist? Or
so there's a little bit, as Sandra said, I think it tries to cover many scenarios, right? Clearly, it covers the scenario where you have your own space. That's clear. It clearly covers the scenario where you go and sit in a committee, a purchasing committee, an advisory board, and there it says, okay, be careful, insider trading. you know, we've had so many stories of collectors sitting in boards. They hear the artist Sophia is going to have a show at MoMA. MoMA Basel, yeah, there's a MoMA Basel. So the MoMA Basel in the board, so, and I'm sitting there as a collector. I hear the artist Sophia is going to show next year. It's not public. I go out, I go to Sophia's studio visit, I buy 10 works for 1,000, and then next year they're going to be 10,000. That's clearly, you go to, in other sectors, you go to prison. For us, it's like, yeah, it's a little getting back of you know, it's okay. So that is covered. So the fully public is covered. The medium public, as you are private, but you participate in institutional life, it's also covered. But also to some extent, Alexander, the very, very private, and I'm sorry, because I know that that's where your freedom space comment earlier on went, there are some provisions there that apply. For example, you know, yes, you buy an object, but it's an object that has a public interest. So you cannot take it home and destroy it. That's what the code says. You cannot take it home and ignore that has to be looked after according to the artist's wish, right? Or you cannot go to the gallery, which is a very private transaction, and say, please give me 60% off because I'm important. Even if that is closed door, very intimate, very private, the code says, think about that. You shouldn't be doing that because you impact what the artist is going to get as an income. You impact the life of the gallery. And the piece of art has, art itself has a right to circulate, to be shown and to be conserved. So even at a more intimate private level, the code goes and scratches that surface.
But actually, going back to what you were saying, it's fantastic if in the Netherlands there are many codes that cover everything. And if this code is not needed because there are other codes that cover it in the Netherlands, that's fantastic. Like you have done the work before anyone else or before many other people. So, and that's why we are going to different places and all over to understand what is the interaction with what already exists, right? And great, let's work together and make sure that it's followed, it's implemented, it's enforced by the discussions, by making sure that we are all aware of it. And yeah, that's all that we need. We don't need to say that this is the only code that should exist. We need to know that, you know, the collecting, as we all do it, is done in an ethical way. So, yeah.
But I'm sure there will be questions, reflections.
Thank you. I have a little question. As a trained anthropologist, I always observe many worlds, and also the art ecosystem is very interesting for years now. And I notice, as in many other parts of the world, people don't know each other, and here as well, like we are together, people who like to collect art, and I also am in contact with people who make art, who are a bit lower than, you know, they're not yet tied to a gallery. How do worlds meet? That's always my question. And also the other question would be, if you have thought about going to schools, to academies, to explain about your code of conduct, because I think the artists need much more tools to defend themselves. Probably, yeah, you're already saying yes. So,
so it's interesting. So just, I take a little step back. You know, if you look, let's talk about business ethics for a sec. Ethics in transactions generally, right? You know, the financial crisis of 2008 started not because people didn't know how to sell mortgages. It started because it was greedy and unethical. Let's be clear, right? Do they teach business ethics in school? No. So what caused a massive failure in the economic system? Still, it's not really taught that much at school, in business schools, you know? The other day I was reading that more than 50% of CEOs today, they don't get fired because they don't do good performance, they get fired because of ethics and compliance questions. Do they teach ethics, business ethics in school still? Very rarely, right? So there is this resistance. And even if it's something that makes the top managers of the world, 50% of them get fired, they're still at business school, they don't teach you how to avoid getting fired off all the time. Isn't that crazy? So let alone starting a conversation in the art schools. I mean, I teach arts ethics in the art sector at Sciences Po. It's the branch of luxury and creative industries, and they loved the idea. But if I went to an art school, and we are contacting art schools, they say, yeah, law is important. I'm not talking about law here. The difference between ethics and law, it's still not clear in the mind of many people. The law tells you what you can or cannot do. Ethics tells you what you should or shouldn't do, right? And so to answer, sorry, that was a little introduction, but to answer your question, we're trying to reach out to schools because it's important that this code is known, but also the other code. So I don't think it should be just a course on the ethics of collecting. It should be a course on the ethics of the ecosystem of the art, in which we play a role, but everyone else plays a role. Sorry, that was a long-winded.
But it is very important to go to the schools and to the art schools, actually. And I think the other partner that is very important here is the public institutions, because they have access to the artists, they have access to the collectors, so we're very happy that we're here. And I think we need to continue. These are spaces where we can meet, you know, whether we are collectors, whether we are, you know, art workers, artists, institutions, and all of this. So I think this is a space where we can have free discussions about all of these things, where we try to be a little bit more horizontal in the discussion, because it's not in a transaction place, right? In a gallery, it's not the same, because someone has the money, someone needs to sell, right? But in places like this, I think it's where we should be having this discussion, including in the schools, in the art schools, of course. But, you know, the artists are part of the system, right? Many of them are there to make a career and make money as well. So it's not like it's only us that, you know, try to make money out of it and the artists do it for the art. So everyone needs to sit around the table and have a frank discussion about how do we move forward in a way which is sustainable for everyone, basically.
Also, two more questions, I think. Rein.
Okay, I'm a collector for more than 40 years, and of course I buy art because I love art, love to look at it when it's home, but it's also maybe available when the artist needs it for another exhibition, things like that. But another reason for me to buy art is that I like to support young artists. And if I see a quality in the works of an artist, because I always go to the exam presentations of the Dutch and even Belgian and German art academies, I see a young artist, and then you think, well, it would be nice to support him or her. That can be an acquisition, but it can also be, well, just to buy the work, to that they have more money, things like that. And so I was quite curious to remarks Mr. Jordanis Kerenidis made, because you had consultant also artists for your ethical codes. So I'm very much curious what kind of specific codes were brought in by the artist. And after now, how will you support with that? Because I think in your whole ethical code development, I think the artist's view is, for me, much more important than the collector's view.
You're absolutely
so
right.
How do you respond on that?
Yeah. So we interacted with many artists. We tried to find artists that also, you know, either through their work or through their texts and stuff, you know, have discussed or have thought about these issues, right? So we talked to Ito Steyer, and we got, you know, her comments back. We talked to Valid Rad, and Valid said, oh, I think artists should do something like that for themselves as well. I was like, yes, if you need any help, let us know. But yes, this is what should happen. Like, artists should say, we need contracts when we sell. We need to get something every time you resell the work. We need to be, you know, in the whole process. We need to know where the work is. We need to know when you sell it. We need to be aware of all of these things. It's on the artist to enforce this thing, right? All we can say is that if you say that, we'll support it, right? And there were many comments that came from the artists, even on some interactions that we didn't have, we never thought about it. For example, galleries not paying them in time, right? It was something that we didn't think of ourselves, right? Because we are not the galleries, let's say we're not the artists. So the artist said very clearly, you have to say something that you should at least advocate that we get paid from the galleries, because many times the collector pays immediately and then we never see the money for a year. And obviously galleries have issues, economic issues. Obviously all of these things have to be taken into account. But this was something that they brought up, and this is part of the code, for example, now.
Yes, and that it was interesting how, you know, because you can say, yes, I pay the artist, as I said earlier on, but how do you go and tell the galleries what to do? We had endless discussions around that. And then we say, this good is not for others, it's for ourselves. But then you can still advocate, and you can withdraw. You can say, I'm not playing with you if you don't play the way I like. That's still something that we can, for once, we use our power for a good cause, let's say. Yeah. So let's use our power for a good cause and withdraw if they're not willing to engage. Mm-hmm. And then another couple of topics they advocated for. One was for respectful communication and stopping harassing or being, you know, we heard about studio visit where collectors go and they're not necessarily respectful or patronizing, so they wanted to be respected. And also, how can, to your point, and congratulations for 40 years of collecting, but how can we support, how can we get supported in a way that doesn't perpetuate our vulnerability, right? There was this, I don't want to receive sort of philanthropic charity. I want to be able to pay my bills and work and be paid. So how can we support you without that support, meaning that without me, you don't pay your bills? You know, how do you stop vulnerability and precariousness? And so these are discussions that we had.
Which ended up in the code as examples of collectors who have already acquired a work by an artist and may ask the artist to come and present something to a group of people or to reinstall the work in a different setting. And all this is labor, is time. So, you know, what's the relationship between the collector and the artist in this situation? Other cases where commissioning, when a collector commission a work, what kind of contract does that involve? Does the collector necessarily get the work back that he commissioned or her commissioned? Does he pay for half the price of the work? So all these situations were also brought up by artists.
And maybe one last situation that was brought up, and it was a very interesting discussion, is how much are we doing this just to feel better for ourselves? And how are we going to enforce it, right? Because it's nice that we say all these things, everyone is happy, but how do we make sure that actually something will change in the life of an artist today, right? So these were very interesting discussions on, you know, actually getting to the core of what the artists need and how to make the entire ecosystem more balanced than us coming and saying, oh, now we have the code. Because the code is really the 10% of what needs to be done, right? Because what needs to change is our interactions between us. It's not to say we wrote the code, we are done, we are ethical now, right? So many of the questions of the artists were, okay, how do you make sure that this is implemented, right? We cannot enforce it, we are not an association, we are not professional collectors, right? So I cannot tell you what to do, right? We can only start discussions and I think to your point, we should have the artists here with us in these discussions as well, right? Because as you said, in the end, it's about how do you support the artists that you have been doing for 40 years? How do you continue to do it?
And things can change, right? And just the day after Arco Madrid, one artist wrote to us and said, I have a foundation in Southern Europe that's asking me to give free artworks because they're opening their space in Southern Europe. And they're asking me and other artists to provide artworks for free because then they will get visibility. And I actually told them, sorry, have you looked at Article 3 point something in the Code of Collectors? Maybe you should think about before asking free artworks. And so that's what we hope to do. That's what we mean by peer-to-peer enforcement. That it's not just the 3, 4, 8 of us to go and talk all day, but also Sophia is someone, you know, I don't know, someone on the board or someone comes and proposes an exhibition to you and they also want to find it. That's probably impacting too much your freedom, your curatorial decision. And you should say, dear collector, well, I'm sorry, but you know, have you perhaps read this? So everybody can help here. We're not an authority, we cannot do it. So that's also what our, and another artist asked us, what about ethics washing? Are you doing ethics washing here? And very valid questions.
But is it not a self-fulfilling prophecy that you say, yeah, you should use this as a mirror, awareness to influence your behavior? But it could get more institutionalized, that institutions say, if we work with collectors, we think that you do this. Yes. Or even that you get a point where you can address misstandings which happen, and then it becomes more... Yes. Institutionalized and so organized.
That's what we're also thinking of, going to galleries, associations, to other collectors' association a little bit later. And if a gallery association says, okay, our templates says that when you sell a piece to a collector, the collector engages themselves to comply with the code. There are tricks that we can do, and we're looking at those, and we're trying to to implement those as well.
Also with institutions, like it should be the institution's code that says, if you as a collector sit on the board, then here are the 10 things that you have to do. Like, I was in the acquisition committee for the National French collection, right? I mean, we had a lot of money and we were doing, I never signed anything. No one told me how to deal with. I went and asked them, am I supposed to propose artists that are also in my collection? What am I supposed to do? Am I, you know, how do I deal with all of this? And, you know, the discussion was, we are here because we know you have a good taste. But that's not how it should be, right?
Not enough.
It should be that it's clear that I'm there for the interest of the collection, not for my interest, right? So at least what we were doing at that point is to say, whenever I was making a proposal, I was saying, this is an artist. By the way, this artist is in my collection as well. These are different pieces, and then everyone would vote. At least we can do some things which are very simple to avoid all these kind of, you know, murky things that happen. And the institutions should be there to make sure that they are there.
But I'm sure that there are reactions from the people here, because on the necessity and where it can go to. Jeroen?
I think that you have very interesting ideas, and I don't know them all, so maybe I ask a little bit stupid questions as well. But did you get paid for your work for that committee?
No.
No.
Why didn't you ask for money?
This is a voluntary committee that is about 10 people. There were some people from institutions, some artists, some curators, and some collectors. It's always the case. So it's a 3-year appointment. It's a voluntary appointment without any money.
I understand that because I was at the board of Melly one time as well, and I know how it works.
Yeah.
You every time you do it for free, and it's supposed to be voluntarily.
Yes.
But I think that the code of ethics is a lot about economic differences between artists, collectors, institutions, museums, and you want to solve it in a way by paying a fair price to artists. But there is no fair price for subsidies to art institutions or for museums, and so they ask the involvement of experts, let's say that you are an expert, for free.
Yep.
So if you don't pay in the normal way we do business with each other, then you make it more easy to use artworks for money.
You're right. It also means that the only people who could actually be in these committees were people that did not have a problem doing it for free. So which means that the people that could actually not spend all this time there because they had to work were not able to participate in the committee. You're absolutely
right. And you also feel like you can get something in return because you're not being paid. At least I get something back. Yeah, but...
who would benefit from this code? Because I think that if we try to economize every relationship in the art world, it will cost a lot of extra money, which is not there. And so probably the people step up, collectors, people who have expertise that don't want to do it for free or are afraid that their reputation will be harmed by codes like this.
Yeah.
Just a small note, because I had the honor to be one of the people that was invited to give feedback in the code. We were told that please let us know how much money you would like for the time you've spent. So in defense of the ethics of collecting, I would like to say that I found that quite beautiful, and it was the only way time in my almost 20 years of curating that someone asked me voluntarily to give my opinion, and they told me that, please, let us know how much money you would like. So, just a small note.
Something to add to that? Or?
We are trying our best, and we have a lot of things to do as everyone else. So, and it's true that maybe sometimes if we have to do things correctly, it will cost a little bit more money. But between that, or some collector saying, I don't want to be there anymore, right? And making sure that the artists and have the means to actually do what they need to do, I think it's clear where to
to be a little more biased. So I would start with the artist, and then if there are some collectors that do not want to continue,
you know, this makes,
you know, let's try to change their opinion. But yeah,
do you know that when you work in companies and they say, look at tech companies, it's difficult to recruit women, we need to spend a lot more time and money to recruit women, this will cost us money if we want diversity, yeah, just pay the money. No, sorry, we cannot work, then the company cannot work. Well, the company will take some delay. Is it your company more important than the public interest of having more women grow? And, I mean, at some point, it will pay money. If we don't want to pay the money, then is it fair? I mean, the fairness of the system is more important than our individual playground, I think. Sorry, that's my view. But I think it's important also, this point that you bring about getting paid on committees, we'll take it, because it is also cleaning the air. You make a wonderful point, and we're going to take it back. And
but it's, I have to say, being involved in the philanthropic sector, this is how it works for many, many decades in the philanthropic sector. So people are asked to be part in committees and on a voluntary basis, so to avoid some kind of conflict of interest as well. So, yeah, I think we inherit that from the philanthropy.
The question is that in some institutions, they actually let you see it if you pay. And so yeah. Now we're saying...
I want to make an interjection here, and I do have a question, but first I want to say something that transitions here. And I think that the culture of philanthropy or of collecting of the artwork really functions very differently in countries. In my experience, I worked in New York for 20 years, and one of the moments that, it's been two moments, I'm just going to mention one, that was really shocking is that as part of working at institutions, their curators are very much part of the fundraising and the cultivation of the financial relations that the museum has with stakeholders. And if you want to do an exhibition, if you want to do a project, you're always having to cultivate the philanthropic side or the stakeholders to be able to develop projects. There's no subsidies of any kind, and institutions rely on trustees and fundraising. And as part of that cultivation, there's a tradition of doing trips, which are now, every museum is doing them, right? But there's been a long history of doing travel trips from the museum members or trustees to different countries. And curators, as well as directors, are part of the people that are guiding, not only creating the itineraries and going. In one of my most shocking experiences in 2004, we took a group of members of the institution that I worked to Cuba. And, you know, there's no galleries there. Galleria Habana is the gallery there, and it is kind of state-run. It was the height of, at that point, of Cuban artists, but there is no structure. It's all informal. And one of the collectors that was joining on the trip, that, of course, you are the interlocutor, and specifically in this case, the translator, because of Spanish and English. And the collector asked me to see if I could negotiate the price with the artist so it could be lower. And I'm like, we are in the poorest country, see, that you've ever visited, and you're asking me to negotiate with the artist to lower the price, which is, the exchange rate was horrible. And I'm like, and I said, no. And they're like, what do you mean? This is your job. And I'm like, no, it's not, you know? I'm like, I can't even translate this for you. This is not, I'm ethically not gonna do it. But I do think that that the code of conduct for collectors does have to be socialized more, because I don't think that they even notice. They're just businessmen that think that that's how things work. And I'm like, no, this is not how it works. And least of all when the artists do not have gallery and the exchange rates are so dramatically drastic and unfair. But anyhow, that's my little anecdote there, and I'm just saying that, again, the extension of the code of conduct for collectors of contemporary art is something that curators and directors that have to be maintaining relationships with stakeholders of which there is a financial dependency is something that is also useful. However, my question is one that relates actually to Per Giorgio, because you introduce yourself as being not just from the lawyer, but actually working in the pharmaceutical sector, which is actually an ethics in the pharmaceutical sector, which in the contemporary art world has been a key discussion precisely because of the Sacklers, the Sackler family's involvement in what's now called art washing, which is also a term that you use in the Code of Ethics. And we have followed very closely here the case of the Sackler and Nan Goldin's activism, because it was really Nan Goldin that gave a wide visibility symbolically to the case of Purdue, or the cases against Purdue that had been already 20 years in courts. And even if the newspapers reported it and so on, it was really the power of Nan Goldin's movement against the Sackler's name in institutions that gave it a global visibility. And so my question to you is, how do you, not just how do you place the work of Nan Goldin, which is activism and not just institutional critique, as someone that we love, Andrea Fraser, but that actually has been widely responsible positively for rethinking and bringing to us a term called art washing in a kind of global sense via Purdue, against Purdue and against the Sacklers. How, in a way, did the Sackler situation or problems funding art washing impact the pharmaceutical world that you work in? And in what ways are some aspects of the of that sector, which is so complicated, actually help you think through the ethics here? So Nan Goldin, Sackler, art washing and name changing, or in this case, how did you call it? Name secession, no? The removal of the names from museums, which is globally taking place even last week already in different museums.
How much time do we have? So, Sophia, great question. You know, as I said, I worked in the pharmaceutical industry for 20 years. I was ethics officer, right? So my job was exactly that, trying to stop situations like that from happening. Not so much the funding of the museum, which per se is not a negative thing, but how the money was generated and unethical business practices that are linked to the pharmaceutical sector, right? So my job was exactly at building compliance program and training people, controlling, doing investigations, monitoring, but most importantly, changing the culture that, yeah, we're here to sell products, but we're also here to enhance healthcare, right? And serve patients. And so that was an incredible experience that I had personally that helped me also understanding how the public interest should prevail over the personal interest. And our profession as ethics and compliance is about putting public interest first. That's why our own code of conduct as ethics officers is that if a company pushes you or doesn't listen to your advice as compliance officer and it's very serious, you should resign because you cannot be in a company that obliges you to breach the law. Okay, so that's my personal experience and how I brought all that to the code. If you read our code, it really mirrors other codes in the pharma sector, in the energy sector. So that's how I brought my experience. Then when you work in pharma, I must be honest to you, we don't talk about Purdue that much in the pharma sector. If you go to compliance and ethics congresses, we don't talk so much about that. It's perceived as a very American issue, but because we don't talk about art as well, right? But we do talk about issues like giving grants and donations to hospitals, not because they need support, but because they increase prescriptions. Or giving money to patient organizations, not because we want to support their campaigns to enhance the disease awareness with patients, but because we hope that when they sit in a committee of pricing and reimbursement, they make our price higher for our product. So this is the type of issues that we look at. And very regrettably, the Purdue case, it's not being discussed in that context so much. But what these guys did was they were promoting unfairly off-label, so outside of the indication of the product. They were putting, you know, profits first. And that is what we see all the time. But that specific case, Sophia, I want to be honest, it's not that much discussed in our sector. And it's a pity. It's a missed opportunity.
Maybe one more thing about this is that I think there is a lot of power coming from the artists and from the activists or the artists, from even within their work, like you mentioned Andrea Fraser and Ito Shale and all these people that they really have pushed the discussion in many areas, including on free ports and things like that, right? What we, there is a part that goes back to the institutions as well. I'm going to take it a bit back on the institutions, because what we're saying in the code, for example, is that if you're supporting an institution, you have to do it transparently, meaning that as an institution, you should not be receiving from money from play from people that you don't know, right? Or not knowing where the money comes from, let's say, right? So to some extent, it was also on MoMA to realize where this money is coming from, right? And say that, no, I can do one less exhibition per year, but I don't have to take money from a place that I shouldn't be taking money as well, right? So I think the institution has a big role to play. I think the artists have a big role to play, because they're the ones that can actually also communicate, make something happen, right? And on our side, what we say as collectors, when we support the institutions, we have to be transparent. We have to say, you know, where it's coming from, right? And it should always be without trying to influence, you know, the politics of the museum, the curatorial aspect of the museum, and anything like that, right?
Maybe to add with a bit of a story, which is not in the code now, I realize, or maybe it is, which has to do with collectors owning works and lending it to institutions where the artist refuses to be present for political reason. So, for instance, there was a story of artists from Lebanon whose work were lent by a collector to an Israeli museum, which can be a political threat to their life. Not even mentioning BDS, so artists who don't want to be present in Israel. And actually, a few years ago, a group of artists from the Middle East, from Lebanon specifically, asked CADES to sign a paper, which would be a letter of agreement that we discussed for many months, just to agree to respect their wish not to be present in certain country until the conflict has reached another situation. But
I see one gray field when I was reading the code of ethics, the ethics of collecting, and we didn't address that. We have the institutions, we have the collector, where this is about how you behave, how you handle, how you do your business. But I think also the gallerist has a very important role. And for instance, if I go to buy some clothes or to buy some wood, you have certain codes or institutions who say this is green wood or here is not child misuse. Should it not be broadened up that also gallerists apply this code? So you as a collector, a kind of security that, because one of the things was that I thought, well, it's a lot of behavior, but one of the points is also that you should held gallerists accountable, that they pay the artist right, that they pay it on time. But I was thinking by myself,
absolutely,
how can I do that? And it will be a better option if gallerist says, hey, we do it, we work this way.
Absolutely. The only thing, what we say in the code, because again, we cannot tell the galleries to do something, we say that we need to hold them accountable if they are not paying the artist, meaning that we should not keep buying works from them, for example, or we talk to the artist to figure out what is happening. But you're absolutely right, the galleries should have a code of conduct, and they do. In many cases, like in France, we talked actually to the Association of Galleries and we sent the code to them to understand how they see things from their side and what we can add on our side and what they can do on their side. Many times this code of conduct exists, but this doesn't mean that these behaviors do not stop to exist. This is the main problem. So yes, galleries are a part of the ecosystem. They're a big part of the ecosystem, and they need to understand how to deal with artists. At the same time, they're on the other side. Collectors and galleries, sometimes they work together to manipulate the market and increase the prices and do all these things as well. So it goes both ways. So we need to not to collude with the galleries for financial gains. We need to hold them accountable with respect to the artists, right? And also we should at some point stop going to the galleries and say, I'm an important collector, I want 20% off, because why not? Collectors, we want to feel special, right? And we feel special when people do things for us. So, but every time someone does something for us, it's something against someone else, and these are usually the artists. So at some point we need to be accountable for that as well.
Well, we're also heading to our end time of 2:30. So I was wondering before thinking who has a question. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you for your valuable work. I have a question or more something that I'm kind of thinking about is, so the intention of your work is, there are, I hear two actually different things. One is that how to bring the art forth, in which you create together actually with the artist and other players, actors in this field, work together, and which is, and the other is how, or is our intention to help the artist, because in that way, I see that already in that you create an inequality because you're putting the artist actually like, oh, the artist is more special, but then it becomes like a, actually there's an inequality in that, you know, that then the artist goes from very special to a victim, and kind of how do you see that? So on one hand, yeah, what is the intention?
You're absolutely right that, you know, I think the right position of the artist is not a victim, right? And we shouldn't, and this is why in many cases we try to avoid saying that we are there to help you or to advise you or to be there for you, right? So the only thing we can say is that we are there to discuss and to listen what you think that on our side as collectors should be doing differently, right? And have this discussion. And at the same time, we do need to realize that there is a power difference in an interaction between a collector and an artist. Because someone is making a living out of selling something, a collector has the economic power to actually buy something. So whether we like it or not, it is not, there is a difference in the role into this in this interaction, right? So on one hand, we have to figure out a way to not perpetuate this benevolent role of the collector, that is the good guy who helps out, which we do, but we need to do it listening to what the artists also need and how they can, you know, get it to a sustainable state that they don't need us, but they are happy to interact with us. And this is what we should, I think this is what we should try to have, this relation with them, that we are there for them, but not for our own, for feeling better ourselves, but because we are part of the ecosystem and this is how the art world will continue to work somehow, but in a more fair way.
Yeah, somehow it's kind of bringing down the collectors to it's not elevating someone, but rather realizing that we are here and maybe we should just interact with others in a normal way and not use our power to influence and create hierarchies. It's a bit,
but yeah, at the same time, the artists have a lot of power. Like Nan Golding had a lot of power, right? Like it wasn't a collector who made the news, it was Nan Golding, and that's fine. So there is power in the artist itself. It is not when it comes to the financial, you know, and we're talking about the majority of artists, right? We're not talking about the blue chip artist that has more millions than we do, right? But in the financial interactions between collectors and artists, there is a difference. But there is a lot of power in the artist, and on our side, the only thing we can say is that we are trying to make sure that the power still stays with the artist, and we're there to see how we can be part of that.
Well, I think speaking as an artist, I think that's a great idea. I love the proposition. No, thanks a lot for your work. It's it's very heartening to see that, let's say, other actors in our cultural ecosystem also take part of a responsibility that generally lies entirely with us when it comes to negotiating and navigating our precarity from collectors to galleries to public art institutions to private art institutions. So this is really great. With all credits in our case in the Netherlands to Platform BK, which is the closest to an equivalent of an artist union that has really worked very hard the last years to at least set basic standards on artist fees, but only applying, of course, to public institutions, and that's exactly where the problem is, that there's a remnant of democracy in the public institution and total libertarianism for the rest, that is becoming increasingly powerful in the process. I was wondering, many artists, you mentioned examples like Andrea Fraser, many artists have also ventured into the form of the contract as an art form, also as a way to negotiate where artworks can circulate, when, how they are validated. Ahmet Ogut recently sold an artwork to Stedelijk Museum with the demand that if activists want to use the artwork as a barricade in protest, that they have to, that they are forced to lend it. And I was wondering how the contract as artwork, if that played a role in the way that you worked on the ethics of collecting.
No. I don't know the collection of all the group, but I would say that many artists at Cadiz, I think in your collection, are playing with that form. So I think it enriched necessarily your relationship to art. The fact that art is also a commodity that can go through a contract, and the contract in itself is a form of relationship and sets different rules. I've just heard recently about a new contract that may happen or not, we don't know, in Documenta, where an artwork would be sold with a contract that also mentions the artist's political stand or the artist's political drive. And therefore, the collector not only has to know about it through the contract, but embrace it as well as part of his purchase. So there's a lot of invention and creativity there that I think is an inspiration.
Totally. Also, in the absence of contracts as an art form, like Hans Hacke would, never do a contract. So the other thing, maybe we close for that because we are maybe over time, is that we are talking with Wage, for example, that they say that they have been working for many years on making the Siegelaub contract into something that should be used, right? And what they said very clearly is that the collectors don't want to do it, or they could not make it, be part of the interaction and of the financial act. And we kind of said, have you had collectors within the discussion to understand what is the thing that maybe, we need to change or something do differently, right? And they said, no, we were doing it only from the artist's point of view. So, and what we proposed, and I think hopefully we will start doing, is actually discussing on actually making a contract, whether it starts from the Siegelaub or a new contract, right? Where the discussion between the collectors and the artists, from the beginning, hopefully will make this contract something that can be used in practice in the coming transactions. So, yeah.
I have a...
Sophia has a question.
Yeah. I have a... First, I would love that if before the program closes that you could talk about Pablo Elguera's art tunes that have been commissioned for the promotion of the code and also that we've been looking at. So if you could just speak a little bit about this and whether the stories that you exchanged are part of that, like where did these images and situations come from? So I want to learn a little bit about that. And then I wanted to ask you not that you have to respond now, but maybe for your consideration or for the future authors of the code, is that what I find in working in institutions for many years now is that many collectors get inspired by our exhibitions and our programs, and they end up acquiring work from the artists that we show, and then you go to another institution, then they follow you and they continue acquiring and so on. And my only request there is in the chapter of institutions, maybe suggest that if you are learning with them and learning about contemporary art, about theory, about new artists, that every time you make an acquisition of an artist that you saw at that institution, that you consider making a donation to the institution for having introduced you. I think that it would really benefit the institutions, because we do a lot of a search and research, and we maintain and foster, we discover artists and we do foster their trajectories. Yeah. And while we're not the galleries that receive a break for the acquisition, we are the ones that where you learn from. So just a suggestion to put there when you buy an artist. Noted. That is
after the fact that we get paid.
I think
when
that
we
would
are.
Be nice.
I'm loving this.
Yeah, thank you so much, Sophia. We much needed last comment. I guess it's just started when we thought about publishing the code. It's a bit of a dry document. Can I say that, Pier Giorgio?
It's a technical document.
Yeah, so it's a, voilà. So, and we wanted to bring artists in the conversation, and we thought very quickly of Pablo Helguera, who not only has a very socially driven artwork and practice, but also works in a museum at MoMA, so knows a lot about the insiders' conflict and witness it directly. And so he developed this practice of art tunes, which are these drawings that are very funny, with a lot of humor. And we asked him if he could contribute as part of the code. He read the entire code. We have several conversations, and that ended up into commissions of these art tunes, who are in the website.
Thank you. I think we have a little bit over time, but I think that's also because we had a very valuable discussion with each other. I really want to thank you to put this on the table in the thorough way you did as a starting point for, getting this, the thoughts behind it and impulses on behavior and developing in the future for the collecting. And I think, yeah, that's also what I see in a discussion. It really addresses points that we all see, things that happen in the art world. And really want to thank you for that. So I want a big applause for them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I think also for Melly, for Vivian, for Sophia and the team for having us here and facilitating this. And I think also for yourself for, participating in this evening, in this afternoon. And we will be here, so I think there will be questions. You can do it in an informal way. And I think also via the website, if people feel the urge to react, there is an... Well, here, scan it here. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.